As Christians, I think it seems such a normal thing to say that we are trusting in God's provision. And yet I want to recognize that that is not always as easy to do as we think. Not necessarily because we're wondering where the next paycheck is coming from. We're wondering where the future will lead and all of its uncertainties surprise us. But rather, we need to receive forgiveness in the depths of our hearts by grace and not by merit. And we need to extend that forgiveness to others by grace and not by merit. We have to trust that God is able to cleanse us of sin. We have to trust that God is able to cleanse others of sin. We have to trust that God is able to cause all things to work together for good as we love Him and are called according to His purpose. And so as we look to the prophet to set us up for this gospel text today, we see that Isaiah 56 begins with these words, "Seek the Lord." There probably is no other calling more important in our lives than to seek the Lord. He is the King of Kings. He is our everything. And yet, so often in our lives, in the busyness of each day, we kind of forget. We get so fixated on what we're doing and what we're about that we allow God's presence to kind of drift from our mind until something comes to remind us. I don't particularly like the next part of that line, "while he may be found," as if, you know, that's a rare occasion, or as if that's going away. And perhaps, you know, at the end of our lives, that has gone away. So seek the Lord while he may be found, while you're living. And oh, by the way, we never really know how long that'll be. So I like to think of this admonition as seek the Lord whenever it enters your mind to do so. Whenever you see a glorious sunrise or sunset, whenever you see a baby in someone's arms, whenever you recognize God's provision for a friend or for yourself, whatever it is that prompts you to recognize that God is present and that God is good, then seek Him. Or whenever life feels challenging and you recognize your desperate need for Him, when you recognize your utter and complete dependency on His grace, on His strength, on His guidance for a future and for so many other things that are so far out of our control, but very much in His control and His knowledge. And then there's this word about the wicked. Now, I know that we all also fall into that category, but the sense of the verse from the prophet is that we are those who seek the Lord, and then what we are to do as those who seek the Lord is to let the wicked turn to Him. Let the wicked forsake their ways, forsake their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and He will have mercy on them, to our God, and He will freely pardon. Some translations say abundantly pardon. This is not only true of others, but it's also true of ourselves. And that is, sometimes we feel bound to the past. We feel like our identity is shaped by the mistakes we made. Or we look at others by the mistakes they've made in the past. We put them in a box. We don't let them forget the mistake they made, which means we're not really forgiving them. And sometimes we create for them a self-fulfilling prophecy. Well, if you're going to treat me like I did wrong, I might as well go ahead and do it Now, sometimes that's just self-justification on their part. But often I hear from teachers as it relates to students that sometimes when a student gets a bad report at the end of the year from a teacher, I'm talking about a citizenship report, something that says, this child is precocious, this child doesn't listen, this child doesn't cooperate. And then that's put into the heart and mind of their next teacher, and you know how that teacher treats them? Like they're precocious, like they don't cooperate. And you know what the student then does? Acts accordingly. If it's true for students, it's probably true for us. And the question then becomes, how do we see ourselves through the eyes of the Father? And how do we see others through the eyes of the Father and through the redemption that is offered to them in Jesus? Will we let them repent? Will we let them turn to the newness of life that Christ offers them? Will we see them as Jesus does? Encourage them as Jesus does? Now, I'm mindful that they know they don't deserve it. I'm mindful that they probably won't believe it. It takes a long time for someone who feels unlovable to recognize love in the eyes of the other. Surely if they knew the truth, I wouldn't be forgiven, we often say to ourselves. And so over and over and over in the church, we remember that his love goes on and on and on. That it reminds us again and again that the heart of the Father is to love and forgive and redeem his children. And we become voices for that redemption. And then this text in Isaiah goes to this very familiar text that so often is quoted in the life of the church. My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, declares the Lord. And I'm just wondering, do we recognize the context of that verse? Do we remember that when God says his ways are higher, his thoughts are higher, that it's in the context of his grace, of his forgiveness, of his desire to meet people where they are and to bring them back into fellowship with him and with one another? Because so often we say, they don't deserve it. So often we say, but Pastor, I got to protect myself. I got to protect others. I can't take a risk. Maybe that's why the risk Jesus took led him all the way to the cross. Because they couldn't redeem themselves. Because we couldn't redeem ourselves. Our grace, the grace that God gives to us and makes it our own, is earned by another. And so we look to him, we seek him, so that the forgiveness can root itself in us and bear fruit of forgiveness in our lives and in our relationships. When we turn to Psalm 27 today, and the Psalms have just been marvelous, it says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? And again, this week, I just kind of kept seeing the expanse of just a word or two. The Lord is my light. What does that mean? It means he shows the way. It means that I have light to see the path he wants me to walk right now. It means that his light overcomes the darkness. It means that light allows us not to be bound up by the, the darkness and the past and the fear and the uncertainty and the blame and the ways people put us into boxes, that there's light, there's hope, there's promise. And then it says not only is our light, he's our light, but he's our salvation. That means not only is there enough grace and light for right now, for this moment, for how I'm supposed to live and how I'm supposed to respond right now, but that the future is secure. My eternity is locked in because of what Christ has done for us. So whatever today holds, I live with hope. I live in the promise. I live in the security of knowing that salvation is assured for me because he is my light and my salvation. So I don't have to be afraid. And just in case you want to sort of only apply that to the little fears, like the person who saw the scorpion in the bathroom yesterday that we, by the way, eliminated. Anybody have any idea who saw that? The Lord is the strength of my life. Whom shall I be afraid? Meaning I find my strength in him. When in the moment of feeling weak, I seek him. I trust him. I believe that he can empower me or those around me for my sake to hold things together. He is my strength, not me, not my abilities, not my wisdom. I'll use them as I can, but my trust and my confidence is in him. And then there's this word right here in the Psalm, verse 3 of chapter 27 in the Psalms. It says this, though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war may rise up against me, in this I will be confident. Now, I don't know about you. Some of you have been in war. Some of you have seen an enemy encampment, hopefully at a distance. That's never been my experience, but I can't imagine really a scarier thing. And especially when the language is, and this is, of course, David speaking, the king of Israel, he says, they're rising up not against Israel, but against me. And it's wonderful the way the psalmist understands the true emotion that we go through. The fear is not for someone else. The fear is for the psalmist himself. Even though all of this is against me, I choose to be confident in my Savior, in my Hosanna, in my Rescuer. I am confident that I am going to be okay, regardless of how the future looks. And I want to say this to you, Desert Hope. Without this confidence, I could not have accepted the call to go to St. Timothy's. Without the confidence that you are firmly embraced in the love and future that God has in store for you, knowing that he is with you, has been with you all along, has worked miraculous things through the giftedness of his people who are Desert Hope. Who are you? He holds your future. Trust in his provision. It will be more than you can imagine. He has great things in store for you, individually, corporately, for this city in and through you. And so we turn to this gospel parable today. First thing we have to remember is the purpose of the gospel. The kingdom of heaven is like this. Jesus really isn't talking about a household owner and someone who has a vineyard. He's not really talking about labor. He's talking about the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. And he says, this is what it's like. And then we hear what would be a very typical story. when it's time to bring in the harvest. Is it called a harvest with a vineyard? It doesn't sound right. He says it is. Okay. When he's bringing in the harvest, when he's picking the grapes, bringing them in, ready to make the wine, what does he do? He goes out and gets the laborers, the day laborers, to bring them in to harvest his vineyard. And he does what everyone does. He offers them a day's wage for a day's work. That's what a denarius is. Now, you may have a translation in your Bible that says it's X amount of pieces of silver or something like that, but it really doesn't matter. What we need to understand is it's a day's wage. It's what a worker gets for working for a day. And then the text says that he goes out 3 hours later and he hires some more workers that are in the marketplace, the day laborers. And now he says to them, I will pay you whatever is right. And then he does that again at the sixth hour, the ninth hour, and the 11th hour. By the way, did you note the 12-hour workday? Just in case you're wondering. I will pay you whatever is right. And now we're left to calculate. What is right? This is, the kingdom of heaven is like this. So what is being declared about the values of the kingdom of heaven that is right? Now here's something that some of us have never experienced. Some of us have not lived hand to mouth. Some of us have never experienced the need to get a check so that on the way home we can buy the food that we need to feed our family. But for a lot of people in our world and a lot of people in Jesus' day, that was exactly the way it was. Without a day's wage, someone was going to go hungry that night and the next day until they came home from another day's labor. The master of the house says, if you will come and work for me, I will give you what you need to provide for your family today. You work today, you feed your family today. That was the nature of a denarius. That was the nature of the agreement he made with the worker in the first hour. So I ask you this. Is it because the labor of the day was worth the denarius? What if one person was stronger than another person? What if one person was just so much more efficient at picking grapes than another? What if the one person who was hired at the first hour picked 2 bushels an hour? I have no idea about picking grapes and whether that's a lot or not. But another picked 10 bushels an hour. Wouldn't it be right, according to the work, that the one who picked more versus the one who picked less would be paid more at the end of the day? Shouldn't the landowner pay attention to the efficiency of each picker and pay them accordingly? Well, we might think that makes sense, but we've got to ask this question. What did they agree to work for? They weren't given some sort of a X amount of bushels pays X amount of money. They were said, you give me a day's work, I'll give you what you need to feed your family at the end of the day. And they said, you got it. They were eager to go to work. And then the graciousness of the homeowner was to make sure that even those hired at the 11th hour could still feed their families the next day. Was that right? It was right in the heart of the Father who provides for us, who meets our needs, who reminds us that we can trust in His provision. The heart of the Father is to take care of us. The promise of heaven is that God will bless you as you turn to him. That even if you wait longer than the other guy, he's still going to provide for you the forgiveness that you need. And then my mind went somewhere else as I just kind of floated around this text a little bit. I kind of asked myself the question, is it really all just about the paycheck at the end of the day? Or might the labor itself mean something? And then when I gathered with the Friday morning women, they asked some questions that enlightened me, as they always do. And they responded right off the bat to the reading of this parable saying, well, it's really about heaven, like the thief on the cross, who Jesus promises, today you will be with me in paradise. Like the person who's lived their whole life evil and far from God, and at the last minute, they repent and ask Christ into their heart and receive forgiveness through his death and resurrection. It's the same thing. It's like, oh. So we're now jealous because they got to live their whole life without God and get him right at the end so that they could go to heaven when they die. I'm not jealous of that. I'm really happy to have God in my life right now. I'm incredibly honored to be able to serve God in my life right now. I don't deserve it, but what an honor it is to do it. And what an incredible experience it has been in the last 10 years to pastor this congregation. To watch how God has gifted his people, to watch how they have blessed not only one another, but this city and this world by extending his love and grace and provision, by extending the service that is theirs through the gifts of God to bless the lives of others. I've gotten several calls from pastors throughout Tucson who, you know, they're saying things like, sorry to see you go and all that kind of stuff. And in that statement is some sort of a question mark that says, we're not really going to lose Desert Hope as a participant in the church in Tucson, are we? We can't afford to have the Tucson church lose the participation of Desert Hope. It's too important. It's been too valuable. And I have said to them as clearly as I possibly can, it's not about me. God is at work. God has borne fruit through his people in this place. And they will continue to follow the light, to be confident in the hope, to be courageous in the use of their gifts and resources to serve the people of Agua Prieta, to serve the people of Gridley, to serve the people of Tucson, to work with other churches to bring honor and glory to God through the unity that he works through his people that are the church. God took care of me yesterday. He's taking care of me right now. And he will take care of me tomorrow. Would you read that out loud? God took care of me yesterday. He's taking care of me right now. He will take care of me tomorrow. And then we end with this incredible proclamation of courage. Amen. It is so. By God's grace, by God's power, amen.